And welcome back to Let's Play Mass Effect 2 Blind. Last episode, we finished the codex, believe it or not. We've read everything. Not flashing. And we found dead fish and cleaned them out. if I'm correct, we have one more. We have one more Firewalker mission to do, so I'm gonna head there before we do anything else.
For you, Commander.
Thank you, Kelly, for interrupting me. How dare you? You'll be flogged at the earliest opportunity. So yeah, Kerrang is where we did the last mission. It was pretty tough. Hope they don't get any tougher than that. I mean, you can tackle them in any order, so it just happenstance that we went there. Yeah, Hawking Ada is 81%. Because I am not going to the Thorn system where we acquire the Reaper IFF. I'm not even going to that system at all. Not until we're ready, because it leads us down a point of no return, from what I understand. Alright, so leaving Hawking Ada for now. Quite a while, anyway. Into the mass relay. Boop. And all this crap in the way. Right. Well, we gotta help Jack. Hades Nexus, we've finished. The Far Rim, we've finished. What is this one? Phoenix Massing, next Firewalker, and Project Overlord. This is, did I look at this Far Rim? Help Jacob at the Rosetta Nebula. Save a crashing ship at Pylos Nebula. Got a lot of stuff still to do. What is this? Omega Nebula. Oh, palladium rich planet, we haven't gone there, we have enough palladium. Help Jacob. Titan Nebula. What is it? Disable infected production line. I think that's for the VI thing. Rogue VIs or rogue AIs. Help Tally at the Valhalla threshold. What is this? I can't see that. Shadowbroker base has been there. You can always go back and... Yeah, because we have to look up Tally and stuff, so, and they probably have new videos and stuff like that. And things to invest in. Ether rich planet. I don't know. We might have mined that already. Eagle Nebula, we finished. It's more frontier, finished. Minos Wasteland, 0%. And nothing to do there. Shrike Abyssal is finished. And Calliston Rift finished. Help Jack. Shadow Sea is finished. Local cluster done. That's Earth and stuff. Soul. Krogan DMZ. Tuchanka, help Grunt and Morden. Serpent Nebula done. And that's it. It seems like we've only finished half these systems. Anyway, heading for... We've done the Far Rim and the 80s Nexus. Okay. Let's head for Phoenix Massing. Overlords that way. So we're in the Tasra system. Check out these planets. Pahur. By normal standards, a large rock planet, Pahur, fiery, is constantly scorched by the white, bright giant it orbits. A dense atmosphere featuring hydrogen, helium, and clouds of vaporized magnesium float over its iron-rich core, making for a truly hellish landscape. Its spectacular temperature prevents any practical exploitation. I get the feeling it's hot here. Now, we're only really looking for Ezo, since we really have enough of everything else. We have no outstanding upgrades to do. And we have over 100k of the others, so I do not think it is needed. At least not this time. So, we're not gonna mine anything here. Sorry, Parker. No attention for you. I did read your description. You'll have to be happy with that. Sarapai. Sarapai, ever upward, is the second planet orbiting the white star Tassra. Sarapai's pressure cooker atmosphere of carbon dioxide and ethane serves as a greenhouse to an already boiling hot surface. Cobalt compounds are frequently found on the crust, giving spectacular blue tinges to its land. Scans from orbital probes indicate its crust contains deposits of platinum, likely to be as unexploited as its sister planet Pahar. Yep, rich in platinum, which you do not need. Palladium as well. Nope. Okay. Fuel depot. Water probe. Ishasara. A gas giant, Ishasara is composed mostly of hydrogen and nitrogen. Its orbit in recent years has taken it close to the mass relay in this system, making it a popular stop for scoop ships to refuel the hydrogen in their thrusters before moving on. Poor results. It's Poe. Definitely passing this one by here. No game. Denied. Alright, 100% this one already. Firewalker's that way. We've got Typhon, the Overlord, going to last, I think. Let's check out Salaniel. Saha? Salahiel. One planet. One planet. Huh. Ikuna. First discovered by the Quarians at the turn of the century, Ikuna is habitable, but a second-tier choice for most species. Circling an orange sun, Ikuna averages below freezing temperatures. This led development firms to colonize at the planet's equator, where the climate is tolerable for agriculture. The Quarians, seeking a homeworld of their own, petitioned the Citadel Council for the right to take over Ikuna, but they had already settled a few hundred thousand Quarians on the planet before approaching the Council. Seeing this occupation as an illegal act, the Council turned a deaf ear to Quarian pleas and gave the world to the Elcor, who could withstand the high gravity of the world far better. Excuse me. The Quarians squatting on the planet were given one galactic standard month to leave, at which point their colonies would be bombarded? Oh my god. Jeez. That's pretty severe, isn't it? The junk left behind by the fleeing Quarians clogs up portions of the landscape to this day. That is really severe. Non-Elcor visitors to Ikuna are advised to use personal or vehicular mass effect fields to lighten the pressure, as the surface gravity will otherwise cause health and mechanical problems. Colony was founded at 2103 CE, population 221,256,200. Capital is Bel Shaddai. Elcor Durawanafon, or in Elcor Durawanafon. Surface temperature -37°C, equator mean temperature is 15 Celsius, and the surface gravity is 4.1 g's. Rich, ooh, got Ezo. Got some Ezo! Yeah! Right there.
Probe launched.
Elcor, pretty nice. You won't mind us taking your Ezo away from you, will you? Of course not. You don't need that stuff.
Probe launched.
Let's see if we can get to 50,000 here. That'd be pretty sweet, wouldn't it?
Probe away.
A little bit there. For me, almost to 45. Any other things around here? Here we go. A little bit. Here we go. Even better.
Probe.
Some bonus palladium. Almost done, huh? Get some more.
Probe launched.
46k. And I think that's all we got. Not making 50k this time. Double check around the bottom. Oh, I hit that. I hit that by mistake. Nah. Hit the button by mistake. Let's try up here. Sometimes I don't go all the way up. That. Nope, done. That's the whole system. Cool. Alright, let's head back here and into the Geth Incursion Firewalker stuff. Chomos. Only two planets. Trigestus. It's like ingesting three things at once. Trigestus is a gas giant named for the first Solarian astronomer to predict planets' occurrences mathematically rather than through direct observation. It has a faint ring system in three moons, Sadacha, Norum, and Bestia. High-altitude clouds can be seen casting shadows over Trigestus's lower atmosphere, where concentrations of methane and ammonia give it an azure color. The planet is believed to be an extrasolar capture. Moderate. Got some stuff. No element zero. Wah wah. Nope. Okay. Yep, 50%, which means this is the last planet.
anomaly detected.
Indeed. Lattesh, translated from a Salarian dialect as "It's still winter," has an almost habitable temperature and abundant water but shows no signs of life. Regular supervolcanic eruptions in the southern hemisphere have shrouded the sun and led to a climate even more bone-chilling than usual. Excuse me. So the surface temperature is minus 35 Celsius mean temperature and minus 53 Celsius with shroud. So of course there is regular supervolcanic eruptions in the southern hemisphere. I'm wondering if we're going to the southern hemisphere or if we're just going into abundant water and a shroud, which is bone chilling and stuff like that.
Probe launched.
There she blows.
I have found something.
Something. To find something. Planetary scans detect signals from sensor pods left on a planet's surface. These pods may contain valuable data. Warning, surface temperature is extremely low. Advise keeping hammerhead exposure to the cold at an absolute minimum. Already I can tell this is going to be a pain in the butt. Let's see if we can find any element zero or something here. So we're gonna rush forward with this, like the sprint burster of speed type thing. Yeah. No probes, just land. Okay. In case we get out, I'm gonna take Zaid and Samara again. Because we never got out of the vehicle and nothing happened. So, my voice is a little screwed up from finishing the codex last episode. Hope it's not too annoying. I'm pretty sure this is our final Firewalker mission. I'm half excited and half ready to be annoyed.
May degrade engine performance. Mission objectives located.
All right.
Caution, engine temperature falling.
All right. Wait. I forgot I changed this. Oh, that's good, right? Oh, we just gotta keep finding a node?
Caution, engine temperature falling.
I don't know which way we go. This way? I see another one. Okay, okay. Oh, wrong button. I'm using the wrong finger on this freaking thing. I'm gonna die.
Extraction complete.
Good. That was close. Oh god.
Caution, engine temperature falling.
Okay. We're supposed to be doing anything other than here than keeping ourselves from dying from the temperature.
Extraction complete. Caution, engine temperature falling.
Yeah. Whoop.
Extraction complete.
6 nodes left.
Caution. Engine temperature falling.
Engine temperature is always falling. I don't know if I could fall there, so I'm just jumping just in case.
Extraction complete.
I've left. Oh, what's this? Getting there.
Extraction complete. Caution, engine temperature falling.
4 left. Hope I don't like miss one, like back there, and then die.
Extraction complete.
I notice we're not filling all the way up now. One.
Extraction complete. Caution, engine temperature falling.
Oops.
Warning, engine temperature below recommended parameters.
We're inside though. Oops, wrong button. One left.
Caution, engine temperature falling.
This is fun though. Where's the last one?
Warning, engine temperature below recommended parameters.
Oh no! No!
Alert. Engine core temperature has fallen to critical level. Engine failure imminent. Extraction complete.
Good.
We've done it.
Yay! Not bad at all. That's the Normandy? Okay, good. Oh crap, we're like ricocheting off everything. Cool. Atmospheric data recovered from all 10 nodes. 125 experience, 2,500 credits, 5,000 palladium. That's what we found. And that's it. Boop. Cool, is that our last one? Message?
Commander, you've received a new message at your private terminal.
Looking here. Yeah, it still says deliver package because I took that paragon thing. This is never going to be done. Yeah, I don't see any stuff here. Looks like we've done it all. All the Firewalkers. Atmospheric data received from Project Firewalker. Commander, a very capable team is analyzing the data you gathered from the Geth's research into atmospheric change. We hope it may open up new avenues for terraforming procedures for future colonies. The tech used in the beacons also contains communication innovations that should help us develop better systems to reduce atmospheric noise. There is no evidence of Prothean activity on this planet. Huh. So we're done looking for Dr. Case, or what? No, we don't care what happened to him, we just want his research. Okay. Got time left, so I say spend that by going elsewhere. Project Overlord, sure. Not gonna start at this episode, but we'll check out the system. One probe. Typhon system. Oh, it's the planet Ite. I remember that from last episode. From last game. Wasn't planet Ite in the last game as well? So let's check out the other planets first. Echidna. Right. Named after an animal on Earth. Echidna. A so-called hot Neptune planet, Echidna rapidly orbits the star Typhon as a nose-to-nose distance, much like a Pegasid or hot Jupiter. Also like the Pegasids, it is believed to have formed further out and gradually migrated to its present position. Its core is higher in rock content than Sol's Neptune, the consequence of attracting asteroids and other debris as it journeyed through its solar system. Good results. Ooh! I saw that right here. There you go, baby.
Launching probe.
So yeah, the Firewalker missions are pretty fun. I really, for some reason, I haven't... Oh, there's one. I haven't gotten a lot of comments on them overall.
Probe launched.
I mean, at least the few first couple missions that I did. But yeah, they're fun, and I can tell that they probably added the DLC as a result to people being pissed that the Mako is not part of the game. So let's put a Mako-like thing, only it's a lot more... Let's say, the word that comes to mind is vulnerable, but yeah, it's a lot more fragile than the Mako. Which is funny, because you think they would improve on... or at least use existing technology.
Launching probe.
Not come out something with something that's more fragile. Oh nice. Yeah, we're gonna bust out the 50K here on this.
Launching probe.
Little of everything here. 50K! Yay, yay, yay! Took me a long time to get this much ESO.
Launched.
Whoop! Nice.
Probe launched.
We are gonna deplete this thing so hard. Double check for any more that I might have missed. Got it all here. Okie doke. Oh, I didn't deplete it. Still moderate with everything else. Ite will skip for now. Let's go to the third planet first. This tiny little thing called Moros. Moros is a small rock planet with a thin nitrogen and carbon monoxide atmosphere. Each city-state of Ite claims the rights to exploit the planet for its heavy metal deposits. Individual city-state governments maintain three small habitats on Moros and far away as far away from one another as possible. Nevertheless, the planet's wars have extended here, and the habitats infrequently send commando teams to assault each other in small unit actions. Travel advisory. The inhabitants of Moros have set large numbers of anti-personnel and anti-vehicular mines at common choke points across the planet. Records of the mines' locations are extremely unreliable. Civilian travel is not advised. Colony founded in 2150, population 27,800, capital none. Rich in resources. Oh my! Morizo, yay! I'm loving this system.
Probe away.
That's why I was still gathering these other resources. I would.
Probe launched.
I'd end up using all these probes. Still tempted when I see them go really high, but I really don't have a use for them. I'm not sure if I'll ever need more. If I do, I'll mine more, you know. As I've done before, but
probe launched.
We seem to be winding down on upgrades. We don't find them as often. And we're like 4 out of 5 on a lot of things, maybe everything. At least.
Launching probe.
$60,000 for the Ezo? Well, should we get to 100k on Ezo, I'll be like amazed. Watch me still collect it just because it's Ezo, right? Planet from the sun? Gas giant? Panos. Panos is a typical hydrogen-helium gas giant. Its once vital helium-3 refining machinery in orbit around the planet was destroyed in one of Eid's many wars, and Eid's extraplanetary trade suffered severely as a result. The dictators of Eid are not pleased with the situation, but they consider it a bad strategy move to be the first to start work on a refinery before eliminating any chance of other nations or planets seizing it. See if you find any more Ezo. I'm not sure, I don't think. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm not sure if I've ever found Ezo in any gas giant. It might be something just found, like within the crust of a planet, that kind of thing. That has crust. Of course. And gas giants are really pretty much made out of gas. If they have a core of crust, people don't really survive to see what's in them. See if there is a core or not, which is solid. And let's just look at Eid. I'm not gonna land this time. We'll do Project Overlord next episode. Eid is an Earth-like world with a variety of habitable land ranging from deserts to jungles to tundra. It also possesses faint rings, an unusual feature for a non-giant planet. The rings contain rocks up to a meter in length and a wide dust cloud that stretches nearly 20,000 kilometers from the center of the planet. This impressive celestial phenomenon, however, is dwarfed by the fact that Eid's largest moon, Lattesh, is in an unstable orbit and is predicted to impact the planet within the next 2 centuries. Knowing that any Eidian venture is living on borrowed time, colonial population and investment has been orders of magnitude less than other garden worlds. Colony founded 2104, population 1,540,000, and the capital is Adrastea, which is disputed. for some reason. Here are the other things. Not too far off from Earth. Stuff like that. Alright, we'll check it out next episode. Until then, thanks for watching, guys. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.